let us straight come to topic 5. The first law. Now, traditionally, if you look, there are many books which teach the zeroth law first. The order goes as zeroth law, first law, second law in teaching. It is not necessary to follow that. What we will follow is a more logical way of presenting things, because you must have noticed yesterday that I have cut many of you short by saying we have not yet defined it, we will look at it later. So, let us not talk about it just now. Our aim is to always go from something which is defined, something which is understood, to something which is to be defined, something which is being explored, something which is being developed. And since I have already spent some time on circular definitions, we would like to see to it that we do not want any circular definitions. We may have forward links. For example, we have already started talking about energy without really defining it. We have yesterday we talked about heat, sometimes temperature without really defining it. But we have not used those concepts in defining anything so far. So, talking about something which is going to come later is one thing, but using that idea as if it has already been defined will likely end up in our creating a circular definition. So, look at the history of the laws. Yesterday we said the history of the laws is such that if you go back, the idea of the second law existed in the Carnot's work way back some 300 years ago. And this, at that time nobody talked about the laws of thermodynamics. In fact, it turns out that Carnot worked using the caloric theory of heat rather than the thermal theory of heat which we have now, the energetic theory of heat. But anyway, there was no other theory of heat. The caloric theory of heat was buried only after the cannon boring experiments of Count Rumford, and it was the new theory was quantified by Joule. But till then the caloric theory worked, and in those days it perhaps worked well because hardly any conversion of heat into mechanical energy took place. Then comes Joule's experiment. And before that, Count Benjamin Rumford's experiment. Benjamin Rumford's experiment indicated that heat is nothing but some kind of motion, that means some kind of work. So, there was the two ideas of work transfer and heat transfer being two modes of energy transfer came up from his work. But it was Joule's experiment which finally led to what we call today the first law of thermodynamics. It is possible to develop the whole of the science of thermodynamics based on just these two laws. However, that development is not very easy to understand. Although there are books and there are treatments which work only with these two laws. So, slightly more than 100 years ago, when thermometry properly developed, we had the third law, third in the order. We had the zeroth law. At that time it was understood that maybe zeroth law should be understood first, because temperature was considered the absolute basic idea in thermodynamics. So, many textbooks even today follow the exposition in the form of zeroth law, first law and second law. And even good physics books like Szymanski and Sears are they do follow this particular methodology. However, when mathematicians got into the act, they realized that the structure is very intermingled, and it is not a good idea to have zeroth law, first law, second law taught in that order or learnt in that order. And the treatment which we are going to follow is we are going to study the first law, then we will go to zeroth law, and then we will go to second. So, that is the type of order we are going to follow, and as we follow, it will be clear to us why it is going to be so. When it comes to first law, we are going to follow what is known as the Carré-Theodoris formulation. French mathematician who put thermodynamics in a proper mathematical framework. When it comes to zeroth law, we will follow a formulation provided by Landsberg and others. And when it comes to the second law, we will follow the Planck, Keenan, Bridgman exposition. Okay. Now, a question arises with students, what are these laws? See, laws of thermodynamics are basic laws of physics. They are our understanding of the way nature works. And since the nature surrounding us is something which we have not created, we can't say that the nature should work in this particular way. Observations observed and generalized. Here, the idea used is inductive logic. I saw something happening today morning at 7 o'clock. I have seen it happening yesterday at 7 o'clock and day before yesterday. So, it is very likely that it will again occur at 7 o'clock tomorrow morning. That is inductive logic. There is no deduction here. It is not like 1 plus 2 is 3, hence 2 plus 1 is also 3. Absolutely nothing of that sort. And these generalized statements are now given the status of a law. Is there a proof? No, there is no proof. Then why do we believe in those laws? We believe in those laws for the simple reason that all proper observations now seem to be in accordance with those laws. Okay. And our belief in those laws, not only those of thermodynamics, but other laws in physics, like Newton's law of mechanics and so on, are the belief is so strong that if we come across a situation where a law is apparently violated, we hardly ever, actually I should say, we never jump to a conclusion that there is something wrong with the law. We say that look, there must have been some error in our observation or our error in understanding what we are being, what we are observing. So, we make that experiment again in detail with proper measurements. We observe all the aspects of that and invariably we have come to the conclusion that look, there has nothing wrong with the law. There was something improper in the way we observed or we conducted the experiment. Okay. So, newer and newer observations have only allowed us to increase our faith in the law. But in the early part, those things allowed us to, you know, fine tune the law properly. This happens sometimes slowly, sometimes after a few decades or after a few centuries. For example, you look up Newton's laws of motion. They were considered absolute till Einstein came on the scene. Okay, the Michelson-Morley experiment started creating some question marks. Then Einstein came and proposed his special theory of relativity and general theory of relativity, to show us that, well, Newton's laws were good so long as the relative speed between bodies was much lower, much smaller than the speed of light. When the speeds approach the speed of light, then a slightly different or more detailed type of physics gets involved, and we have the Einstein theory of mechanics and Einsteinian theory of gravitation. But when there are small masses, small gravitational effects and lower speeds, that theory automatically reduces itself to the Newtonian theory. So, Newtonian theory was not proved wrong, but what was proved that Newtonian theory is true in a certain zone of physics. Moment you cross that, you are naturally going away from the tenets of Newtonian theory. The same thing is true here. our thermodynamics, because we are assuming that it is a continuum thermodynamics, it is based only on phenomena and not on microscopic particulate observations. So long as we are in this classical domain, our laws will work. But if you go to the microscopic domain, these laws as they stand may not work. These laws may not be proved wrong, but these laws will need to be modified. Similarly, today our understanding of physics restricts ourselves to within our observable universe. Now, our observable universe is perhaps too small a part of the overall universe, maybe the unobserved or unobservable part is much, much larger than what we have observed. So, maybe our laws of thermodynamics will need to be modified when we go to observations much beyond what we are capable to do. So, these laws are sort of inviolate so long as we restrict ourselves into the domain which we have charted out. Beyond that, what happens? At today, we do not know, but we are open that it is possible that these laws will have to be modified. Now, we come to the first law. Notice that what we have done so far is we have understood what is meant by a thermodynamic system, its state, interactions, and particularly we are now comfortable with the work interaction. We have created a thermodynamic definition of work and we know how to determine or evaluate the work interaction in certain class of processes. We have appreciated that it has various modes and all that. Okay. To follow the Carathéodory's formulation, we now define the adjective adiabatic. Adiabatic is defined to mean a short form for work transfer only. So, this can be applied to any entity, any process, anything with which work transfer is involved. Now, we know work is a transfer of an energy in some form between two systems across a boundary. So, the adiabatic adjective can be applied to a boundary or a wall or a partition or an interface, different names for boundaries. So, an adiabatic boundary or wall or partition is a wall which allows only work transfer across it. And hence, since we have a method by which we can determine whether an interaction is work transfer or not, we can determine whether a boundary is adiabatic or not. See what is the interaction across it. If we find that only work interaction is taking place, well, we do not have to worry about the quantity, it is adiabatic. If we find that something other than work interaction is taking place, it is non-adiabatic. Since boundaries belong to a system, this can also be applied to a system. An adiabatic system is one which will be completely enclosed in adiabatic boundaries. So, only interaction it can have is a work type of interaction. It can also be applied to a process. A process is an adiabatic process if the interaction during that process will be executed by a system. So, that during that interaction, during that process, only work is done. If you find that some non-work interaction is taking place, then well, it is not an adiabatic process and the system involved is not an adiabatic system, and at least some part of the boundary of that system must be a non-adiabatic boundary. So, this is the definition of our work, the word adiabatic. It means work transfer only. Why do we define it like this? We define it like this because we have defined only work so far. So, when we define something else, we are going to use only the concepts which have been defined so far. So, in the idea of adiabatic, we are not going to use the concepts of temperature, heat, etc., which we are yet to define. Now, after having said so, the first law. So the first law is based on the behavior of adiabatic systems. And this is the Carathéodory's form. Carathéodory's form says like this. Take a system, must be an adiabatic system. Let it execute a process from a fixed state. So, adiabatic system is the one requirement. 1 and 2 are fixed states. This is the second requirement. And then what Carathéodory said is, execute any process from 1 to 2 with the requirement that this be an adiabatic process. I will use the adjective adiabatic. Process may be quasi-static, process may be non-quasi-static. There is no restriction on the process except that it is an adiabatic process and starts from a given state 1 to another given state 2. And the statement, basic statement, is the work done by this adiabatic system in going from fixed state 1 to another fixed state 2, any adiabatic process, quasi-static, otherwise, whatever, no restriction except that it is adiabatic, is independent of the path and any other detail. By any other detail is, it is possible that you use one work mode in one process, maybe use another work mode in another process, maybe in the third process you have combination of the work modes, whatever. The requirement is, that is the consequence of this. Okay. So, this is the statement, absolute basic statement of the first law in the Carathéodory's form. And we use this because what is required is definition of adiabatic, which requires definition of work interaction, which is already done, requires definition of two states and a process which has already been done. So, we are not using any idea which has not been defined. How do you determine whether a process is adiabatic or not? Determine whether only work transfer takes place. How do you determine that? We have the operational definition of work. How do you define state 1 and state 2? Measure the properties, the unique set of properties, state 1, unique set of properties, may be different, at least one property is different, could be state 2. Now, consequences. The immediate consequences is WAD 1-2, because it is path independent, DW adiabatic must be an exact differential. Path independent, that means this integral 1 to 2 of dW adiabatic must be a point to point integral rather than a path integral. Whichever path you take, it would lead to the same value. And now we use the characteristic of properties which we said yesterday, that if for a property its differential is an exact differential. So, any thermodynamic entity whose differential is an exact differential must be the differential of a property. and this means that dW adiabatic must be differential of some property, and W adiabatic, sorry, must be the change in the property. Which property? This property which we are talking about, between states 1 and 2. Now, the next question is, which is this property? It turns out that Carathéodory defined this property as E. And he called it energy. Why energy? That we will soon see. The reason is, he proposed it like this and he found that it is consistent with all other observations and the derivations and work so far. And he defined this E, because dE has to be dW, he defined dE as minus dW adiabatic. And which means, in the integral form, E 2 minus E 1, which is delta E 1 2, was defined as integral or minus integral d w adiabatic 1 2 any path. Yes.
Here it is seen that there is something other than work transfer also.
No, only the work transfer difference in an adiabatic process is defined as energy difference.
Okay, the work has given the name energy.
Yes, the work transfer in an adiabatic process is given the name energy difference between those two states. That is the definition. Okay. Remember, everything is adiabatic. We have not gone away from non-adiabatic, to non-adiabatic. That we will do soon. Now, the question is, why energy? The reason is, after we complete the formulation, we find that the final form is absolutely consistent with all our observations. Okay, that is the only reason why laws are accepted. Second thing is, why this negative sign? Well, it is a matter of convention. We are mechanical engineers, and mechanical engineers and physicists tend to use this negative sign as a matter of convention. But our chemist cousins or chemical engineer cousins, they tend to keep a positive sign there. It is a matter of convention. So, let me use a different color here. This and consequently this. So, negative sign is a matter of convention. No, nothing. Even in work interaction, remember that we said raise of a mate means positive work. Raise of a weight, we said yesterday, positive. Was positive work. Why positive? We could have made it negative there. That was also a matter of convention. Okay, yeah, so, there was one sign convention.
I want to give an explanation. In the development of thermodynamics, PdV was defined. For dV to be positive, work to be positive,
then,
it's natural.
That is what we feel. But chemists feel, no, it should be minus PdV.
Sir, no. When you take dV as positive, the integral gives us positive work.
Yes.
And so,
no, that is a convention.
Which got
dV
followed.
dV is positive gives you PdV as a positive value.
Yes.
But it need not be defined as positive work. I can define dW expansion as minus PdV.
True, but what we accepted is this itself, that dV being positive, we take dW
as
positive.
Yes, but we have accepted it as our convention.
Yes, exactly. But
right.
I am saying that
so
maybe the reason.
So, there is convention involved. There is no requirement.
I Hello, that saying that is the reason why we could have accepted, or the earlier scientists could have accepted.
Agree. We have could have accepted that, we could have accepted other. But remember, that was a convention which we used. Here also we have used a convention, and I am sure there are textbooks which assume the other type of convention. Yes. Now, another reason which sometimes I get, sir, this is okay because, you know, if we say this is energy, then, you know, when I work out, I am exhausted. So, when I do work, my energy reduces. So, there should be a negative sign. But again, that's our feeling. Chemists say that, look, or a housewife says that when she kneads dough, the energy of the dough increases because she is doing work on it. Okay. He says that's the way a housewife looks at it. But that's the chemist or a chemical engineer's way of looking at it. Now, notice that so far we have come to delta E between two states is minus W adiabatic. If I remove that 1, 2, 1, 2, which is common. This is the first quantitative statement of the first law. You can say that this is the definition of delta E. Of course, between two states, actually you should have the hidden thing here is this is delta E 1, 2, this is W adiabatic 1, 2. That is hidden here, anything which is common. Now, the next thing is, and mind you, again, let me make a strong statement. This is the only statement which links change in energy to anything else in thermodynamics, because this is definition of delta E. If after some time we find a relation which is delta E, it's something else, which is not obviously or not directly seen as minus W adiabatic, that must be a derivation from this. Remember. Now, we come to the further development. What about a non-adiabatic process? So, now let us consider a situation. I am writing x1, x2, you can write PV, whatever, anything which we have defined so far. Let us say we have a system which executes a process from 1 to 2. Let us say, because the first law as depicted so far does not depend on whether the process is quasi-static or not. Let us say, let there be an adiabatic process joining states 1 and 2, let us call it W12 adiabatic. Let the work done during this process be W adiabatic 12. Let there be another process, quasi-static or otherwise, which I will call without any subscript. So, the work done in this adiabatic process is W adiabatic 1, 2. Should use the same color. Why is it? Now, the blue process, let us say that the work done during this process, same end states, let it be W adiabatic. Sorry, not W adiabatic, simply W. W 1, 2. Not necessarily adiabatic. This is adiabatic. This is general. I am not saying, asserting it is adiabatic, any. Now, since this is not adiabatic, if it were adiabatic, we would write W12 is W adiabatic 12. That is our basic statement of first law, Carathéodorys form. Since this is adiabatic and this is not necessarily adiabatic, we now write that W12 where now here the symbolism is slightly different, and we will come across this again and again. In mathematics, when I write A is not equal to B, it means A is strictly unequal to B. Okay? A is not equal to B, it is satisfied only when A is say 1 and B is 2. It is not satisfied when A is 2 and B is 2. But here there is a difference. Here not equal to means not necessarily equal to. In fact, if you want to be mathematically strict, this should be W equal to WAD12 or W not equal to WAD12. Both are accepted. Whereas mathematically not equal to would mean if you put left side minus right side, it has to be 0. Here it may be 0, it may not be 0. So here, yes, it is conceptual, not necessarily equal to. Okay. Yes, if this blue 1-2, the unmarked process, if it were adiabatic.
But followed by the other path instead of that above path, if it is in the same path of what?
See, I am not talking of the path here. Path is immaterial. I am only saying let there be one process shown by black here which is necessarily adiabatic, and let there be another process shown by blue here which need not be adiabatic, need not be. I can assert that it is definitely not adiabatic, then I would say this is definitely mathematically unequal. Because if it is not adiabatic, well, some other interaction may be taking place, and then I am not sure Carathéodorys statement can be applied. Now, based on this, we come to the next definition. Definition of quantity Q. Let me just call it Q. Carathéodorys defined that Q interaction, the non-work interaction, he defined as W12 minus W adiabatic 12. So, what Carathéodorys says is, let me go back. Take a system, take two states 1 and 2, and some process as shown by blue here, which is not necessarily adiabatic. So, if it is not necessarily adiabatic, there is likely to be some non-work interaction. And he decided to quantify the non-work interaction by means of the symbol Q, and he defined it as follows, that the non-work interaction between the for the process shown in blue between states 1 and 2 of a given system was W12 minus W adiabatic 12. Connect the two states by an adiabatic process, find out this, measure this, the difference is Q12. And he called Q12, just for consistency, as the heat interaction. This is the definition of the heat interaction. And of course, if I give some numbers to this, for example, if I call if I call this set of equations as equation 1, and if I say this is equation 2 or relation 2, and then I call this relation 3. Equation 1 is the definition of delta E. Equation 2 is the assertion that process 1, 2 is not necessarily adiabatic, and equation 3 is the definition of the heat interaction.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, yeah. Sir, is there any specific reason why the definition is defined as W12 minus WAD12 and not WAD12 minus?
Again, a matter of convention.
Okay.
And finally, we will see what would have happened if we were to take a different convention.
Okay.
So this is the third convention, that Q12 is defined as W12 minus W adiabatic 12. It might as well have been defined as W adiabatic 12 minus W12. If we were to do that, we will get a slightly different form. But because the sign convention is different, when we apply it, we will have to plug in numbers with appropriate signs. The final result would be the same. The quantitative result would be the same. Now look at equation 3 and look at equation 1. Definition of energy or energy change and definition of the heat interaction. Now combine 1 and 3, because minus W adiabatic is nothing but delta E12, and you get Q12 is W12. Plus delta E12. And since 12 is a common thing, we can write in a general way Q is W plus delta E or delta E plus W. This is, I call it, equation. Now, I am going to write this equation again on the top of next page, because we will spend some time on discussion. Q equals delta E plus W, or W plus delta E, does not matter. I have a habit of writing delta E first. This is equation 4. This we call the final form of first law of thermodynamics. But remember that it has in it the following things hidden. The basic first law that W adiabatic is independent of the path is hidden there. We have made use of that and defined delta E. So the link to that hidden first law statement that W adiabatic is independent of the path is the delta E here. Then we have defined Q as W minus W adiabatic. Use the definition of delta E to come to this form, which according to us now is the final form of first law. But remember that definition of delta E is equation 1, and definition of Q is equation 3. And this is first law plus definition of heat. So this, although we say is the statement of first law, we can say this is the final form of first law. And now you see here, write down that this includes the first law statement, definition of delta E, and definition of Q. Now I will make a statement which I am sure a few of you will object. This statement I have been making in front of my students, and initially even my teacher, Professor Achyutan, objected to it, and I had a 1 hour argument with him, after which he agreed that my statement was right. Unfortunately, I have not come across a simple textbook, I mean college level textbook, in which this statement is made. I make a statement that this equation, equation 4 here, is the equation in this form, after including this definition, which relates Q the heat interaction, to anything else involving that system. If you come across any other relation between Q and anything else, like Q equals mCp delta T or mCv delta T or m into latent heat, that must be a derived form from this equation. Do you agree? Yes or no? Okay, think over. If you have a disagreement, I am available till tomorrow evening or even later by email. Now, after that, let me talk of another thing. Is there is a plus Q here, there is a plus delta E here, and there is a plus W here. All three signs are because of a convention. The sign in front of W is plus because we have said that whenever the external effect of the behavior of a system is the raise of a weight, we say work is done by the system. We could have said that work is done on the system, give it a negative sign, then there would have been a negative sign in this form. Then we said that because of another convention, let us define delta E is minus W adiabatic. We have a mental set that if a system does work, it gives out something, its energy must be reduced. So, again a convention. Because of that negative sign, there is a positive sign in front of delta E here. If we were to put a positive sign there, this would have become a negative sign. Then we have defined Q, our equation 3, as W12 minus W adiabatic 12. We might as well have defined it as W adiabatic 12 minus W12. That would have been another definition of Q. Fortunately, almost all definitions of Q are of that kind. I have not seen a group of scientists or engineers using heat rejected by a system to be positive. Everywhere heat absorbed by a system is positive. So, linked to that because of the calorimetry. So, but remember there also is a convention involved. So, do not get carried away if you see a slightly different form with a negative sign, one or two negative signs. You must accept it, saying that look, maybe his convention is slightly different, but check that his convention is different. If the convention is the same as ours and if there is a negative sign, then there is something wrong somewhere. Then now I will rewrite this form in the form delta E is Q minus W. Notice that on the left hand side we have something which depends only on the change of state. On the right hand side, we have interactions. Change of state, that means delta E depends only on 1 and 2, initial and final state. Because these are interactions, each one of them depend on 1 and 2 and process detail. On the left hand side, we have change of state of a system involved, and hence left hand side talks only about one system. Change in energy of a system. Right hand sides are interactions. So, those are energy transfers or energy transports between two systems. So, on the left hand side only one system is involved. On the right hand side for Q at least two systems will be involved. One of them the system which is represented on the left hand side. Again for W two systems must be involved, at least one of them a system on the left hand. If I write this in the differential form for a process element, this becomes dQ minus dW. dE being the differential of a property or differential of a state function, point function, is an exact differential. The right hand side, the dQ and dW are not exact differentials, inexact differentials. And hence, quite often you will find that this d and this d, because it is inexact, is represented by either a d prime or a d with a cross, or sometimes even by a lowercase delta, just to indicate that it is an inexact differential. You will find many textbooks strictly following this. I do not insist that we follow it, but we must every time remember that dQ and dW are inexact differentials. When you integrate them over a process, you will end up with the integrated quantity Q or the integrated quantity W. Don't write delta Q, delta W. Delta pertains only to a property of a system. So, when you integrate DE, you have delta E. But when you integrate DQ, you have only Q. Okay. Remember in mechanics, the professors spent some time on the difference between distance and displacement. Between two points in a plane, the displacement is the same, the vector joining the two. Okay. But the distance will depend on the path you follow. For example, if you take Mumbai and Pune, the great circle displacement is, you just need to know the latitude longitude of Mumbai, latitude longitude of Pune, and maybe the altitude, and you can find it out, coordinate geometry. That is the displacement. But the distance you travel as you go from a given point in Mumbai to a given point in Pune depends on which road you follow, or whether you took the train, and again whether the train was on the fast track or whether on the slow track. Which track did it take of the three in the ghats, or did you follow, did you take a flight, and which route the aircraft followed. Okay. So, similarly, Q and W are like distances, depends on all the details. Whereas delta E is like a displacement. Okay. Now, you can write this as Q equals delta E plus W, or W plus delta E, or you can write delta E is Q minus W. These are just transpositions of the whole thing. When you start applying this, remember that thermodynamics is consistent with other branches of physics. We can't do anything which puts other branches of physics into trouble. We can augment them, we can extend them, but we can't do something which leads to inconsistency. We have already seen that W is made up of number of work modes. This would be W expansion plus W stirrer plus W electrical plus, depending on the complexity of the systems, you will have a number of components of work. Different modes of work. It turns out that something similar is true for delta E. Other branches of physics have defined other forms of energy. For example, in mechanics, we have simple, minimal thing is the kinetic energy in a given frame of reference. If there is a gravitational field, there is a gravitational potential energy. Okay. Complicated mechanical systems like a spring, there is a, you know, elastic energy involved. Then if it is a dielectric, then we have the electrical energy involved of charging, discharging. Diamagnetic, we will have magnetic energy involved. So, we find that delta E is made up of various forms of energy, delta E mechanical which could be delta E kinetic plus delta E, say, elastic plus maybe other, depends on how complex the solid is. Plus we will have delta E gravitational potential plus delta E electrical. Again, depending on the type of system and the type of situation the system finds itself in, you will have various components of energy. It turns out that even if you suppress a change in all other components of energy, there is one component of energy which remains. And when you do all that, that component we call delta U. This is the what we call the thermal energy. So, the definition of delta U is subtract from the energy change, components of energy changes or energy changes pertaining to any other phenomena like mechanical, electrical, kinetic, potential of all kind, and what finally remains is delta U. That is because it has nothing to do with any other branch of physics except thermodynamics, we may call it thermodynamic energy or simply thermal energy. So, this happens to be definition of delta U. Now, if we have a situation where our system is at rest, so kinetic energy is 0, change in kinetic energy is 0 during a process, change in gravitational energy is 0, and no fields affect it, or if there is a field like gravitational field, it does not move in that field in any way, move in a general way, in which case the changes in energy of other components will be 0. Under such conditions, if there is an energy change of the system as dictated by first law, then that change must be the change in thermal energy of the system. And in many of the simple situations, we find that, for example, again heating of water in a bottle or in a vessel, all other energy changes will be 0. So, the energy change would essentially be energy change due to delta U. And hence, quite often this thing is written in its reduced form, Q equals delta U plus W. But remember, Q equals delta U plus W is not a general form. It is a form in which we assume that the system is at rest and all other components of energies do not change. So, Q equals delta U if delta E is delta U, assumed or demonstrated, then we end up with our textbookish form Q equals delta U plus W. Okay. But I insist that whenever you derive something from first law or derive or start solving a problem, always start. Recommendation, or maybe I will use the doctor's sign, recommendation is always begin with Q equals delta E plus W. Then make appropriate assumption, including this assumption if needed, and then derive the applicable form. See, if you look at our equation Q equals delta E plus W, look at it from mathematical, or if you expand this as delta U plus delta E other plus W expansion plus W stirrer plus what you have. Notice that we have just one equation. the number of unknowns in that equation will be a reasonably large number. Even in the most general form, there is one equation and three unknowns. And as you start putting in the components, you will end up with a larger number of unknowns, but the equation is still one. So there is no fun in this, you know, large number of unknowns means there are n unknowns, n minus 1 will have to be specified, and then you extract the value of the remaining nth unknown. Depending on the process, maybe we will be able to determine W expansion, W stirrer and all that. Maybe depending on the what is happening and our knowledge of other branches of physics, we may be able to determine delta E others. The question then arises is, what does delta E or delta U in this expanded form depend on? Well, it depends on the state of the system, no doubt about it. But then how many properties do we need to determine uniquely the value of U? And what is the relation between those properties and U? Actually, thermodynamics does not really help us. U, how many properties? Which ones? If we come to the conclusion that three properties, which three properties? And in what way? That means, what is the relation? If the three properties are say x1, x2, x3, what is the relation between U and x1, x2, x3? Or between delta U and delta x1, delta x2, delta x. Because remember that the first law form has only delta E and delta U. It only talks of change in energy of some form or the other. It does not talk of energy by itself. So, continuing these three questions, 1, 2 and 3, it turns out that for 1, how many properties? There is an answer, and the answer is known as state postulate or state principle. Second statement. This says that the number of independent intensive properties, independent is more important, intensive properties is a minor thing. That means you can say number of independent properties for a system of fixed mass, because the moment you fix a mass, even a non-intensive property, extensive properties can be converted into an intensive property. Required to uniquely define the state of a system equals, now remember yesterday I used 2W, N2W, number of two way work modes. So, it says number of two way work modes plus 1. And the moment you uniquely define the state of a system, well, all its properties including its energies would be defined. So, to define the state of a system and define its energy uniquely, the number of independent properties needed are the number of two way work modes plus 1. Okay. At this stage, we will not prove this, take this as a principle or a postulate, but after studying the second law and deriving some relations between properties based on that, we will come to almost the doorstep of the proof of this. The actual proof requires rigorous differential mathematics. We will not do that, but we will get a demonstration that how this is consistent with the property relations that we are going to derive. Now, as a consequence, let's see what happens. Suppose we have a simple system. For simple system, how many two-way work modes? One. Okay, like a gas, simple compressible system, one two-way work mode. So the number of properties required are two. So two properties, for example, pressure and specific volume, or pressure and volume will define the state. Pressure and volume also happen to be primitive, so even the state postulate one is demonstrated. By convenience, we may use pressure, temperature, but we have not yet defined what we mean by temperature. Complex system. Greater than 2. Rudimentary system. Note this, when it comes to zeroth law. Now this one means, what does this mean? This one means that every system will have at least one thermodynamic property associated with it. So that means there is no system in the world which is unaffected by thermodynamics. Okay. And since there is one property associated with it, whatever be the property, the energy will be directly related to that property for a rudimentary system. So every system will have an energy and will have some property, at least the energy, which is a characteristic. And since we have said that any thermodynamic system which should have at least one property, and that is volume, for a rudimentary property, all properties would be perhaps dictated by its volume. Perhaps. Okay. Let us see. That was the answer to the first question. We have two more questions. Which ones and what way? 2 and 3. Which properties and in what way? Thermodynamics does not provide any answers. Thermodynamics says which properties? Well, choice is yours. Okay, depending on the type of system, if we later on there will be some restriction based on the phase rule, if we have a two phase or a three phase system. So there will be some restrictions. But again, thermodynamics does not say you must use this property or you must use that property. Again, which way? Again, thermodynamics does not answer. Suppose you decide P and V to be the properties, which way should U be related to P and V? Thermodynamics does not give any answers. However, after doing second law, we will realize that thermodynamics, although does not dictate how properties should be related to each other, it dictates certain restraining conditions. It says that if pressure varies with volume like this, maybe temperature should vary with entropy like this. So some linking relations it does, like a structure of a Indian musical raga. Beyond that, you are free to do. So long as you follow that structure, you are free to do whatever you feel. Now, because of this, at this stage, we cannot remain with generalities. Generalities have to be over. We have to be more specific so that we can solve some numerical problems. Because if the relations are not known, we can't do any number crunching, right? And we have also seen that so far, apart from basic definitions, we have defined the work interaction, we have defined the energy as either delta E or delta U, and we have defined the heat interaction. We have not yet defined what is meant by temperature. So, we now go to the
we say if we remove everything else, delta U remains.
Right. What remains is delta U.
No, but what we remove is also not clear.
No, what we remove is clear because we look at the other branches of physics. Say, for example, we say that mechanics defines mechanical kinetic energy.
No, so here we are defining complement of delta U without knowing what delta U is.
No, complement of delta U or other branches of energy are already defined in other branches of physics. So we take them as primitives. So in delta E, we write delta E is delta E primitive components as defined by other branches of physics, plus if anything remains, that is delta U. So delta U's definition is delta E as comes out of first law minus delta E all other primitive components. So you have a system which has a mass, so mechanics comes in. Oh, if it has a mass, then if it moves, it should have a kinetic energy half mv squared. So if the initial state has a velocity v1, final state has a velocity v2, mechanics says that the change in kinetic energy is half mv squared, mv2 squared minus half mv squared. Then it says if there is a gravitational field and it goes from a height z1 to z2, the difference in potential energy is mg z1, mg z2 minus mg z1. So that becomes delta E potential, gravitational potential. Then your professor of electricity comes in, oh, it is electrically charged. So in a field, if it moves like this, the change in energy is this. Put that on the right hand side. Okay.
What are the things that come in thermodynamics that we have not?
See, thermodynamics really ends with delta E is Q minus W or Q equals delta E plus W. These are only the consequences of working with other branches of physics. We cannot isolate ourselves with other branches of physics and later on even of chemistry, right? So we have to be consistent. And somebody claims that, look, this much is my money, this much is my money. So you have to say what remains must be my money, that is delta U. Okay. So definition of delta U is delta E as defined by thermodynamics minus delta E as claimed by any other branch of physics.
Somebody else claims C also.
No. If somebody else were to claim T, T will not have been a thermodynamic quantity. It would have been defined in mechanics. It is not defined in any other branch of physics. You ask them what is temperature. They said, what? You teach thermodynamics. You should tell me what temperature is. See, work is a primitive. We have not defined work. We have put work on a consistent thermodynamic definition. So we have a thermodynamic definition of work because we find that other branches of physics have slightly different definitions of work interaction. As we said, something just falls down. Mechanics says that, well, force of gravitation into the distance is the work done. They don't talk of a system A, system B. In thermodynamics, we have to talk about system A, system B. So at this stage, we are at the end of section 5.